You can still get your life back. Get your life back. It's real. Get your life back. Get your life back. Hi, guys. I got to find out what's been happening. And I want to address the assessment that I sent through an email. And I'm looking at some answers. And I want to address them. And I want to maybe help you get more clarity or bring more clarity or get you to think a certain way. Maybe you missed something, anything. And then actually you can ask some questions here as well. Even if you are taking a part of the course and you're at a certain, I want to know where you are. I was going to say at a certain place. How's it going? Because everybody's at different places. And I made it self-paced because I didn't want it to be stressful. I wanted to work well with you, but I also want to keep you accountable. So that's what this group is all about, staying accountable to the process. And you could always go back into the group if you need to rewatch a video and look at some of the content on there. That's part of keeping yourself accountable as well. And I'm speaking accountable because when I'm looking at the responses to the assessment, that's a current theme, or that's a popular concern I see, is that sometimes the issue is staying accountable. But you know what, really, that's a lot of our issues. That's like a main area. That's why people go, if they got a goal of losing weight or, you know, eating healthy, they get a fitness coach, or they get some kind of fitness or health dietitian, or some kind of professional in that area, because they know it's difficult for them to do it themselves. And that's why we need support, however that support looks like. You know, if it's a family member, if it's a spouse, a friend, a significant other, someone to kind of keep you accountable, somebody who cares about you and they care about the way you feel about you, you know, not just feeling about them, but they care about the way you feel about yourself. That's when, you know, one indicator that you have a good person on your team, because they're concerned about your well-being. And so that's your priority. And so that's some clarity too for some of you guys who are concerned about, you know, what is your passion and your purpose for this season? I want you to think about, one of the questions I would ask you now is, what do you feel like doing now? How do you feel? What do you see yourself doing in this season? What will make you feel happier during this season? Because I don't want you to get stressed about this one thing and this purpose, because I think a lot of times we can get caught up in that, and if we feel like we don't get it, oh my God, we become disappointed in ourselves. And that's why I talk about in the course, sometimes your purpose or your passion even, it may change. Some things are seasonal. That's what I want you to get. Some things are seasonal. So think about, what would you like to be doing now? How could you serve? If it's to serve others, how could I serve others now? Do I need to make myself more, not as expendable, but do I need to open up more connections? Do I need to get out and be more social? Do I need to go to some conferences and meet with some new people and form some new circles? Because sometimes we have to get out of the mundane things that we do every day, because it's nothing different. We're doing the same thing every day. So you have to break up that monotony in that area. And so you have to put yourself around people in the right circles that will help, if you know what your purpose and passion is, keep it alive, keep you inspired, or you find out more when you are in those circles, because it's something about interacting with other people. Even like going to church, there's something about a corporate blessing, a corporate anointing, when God blessed the whole house, when the Spirit of God moves over the whole house and everybody is blessed in so many different ways. It's like that when you go to these conferences and you go to retreats, and I forgot all the other names, but when people, you gather together, sometimes networking events, and it wakens up something inside of you, a dream, a vision, or maybe something you thought about a long time ago. And just being in the midst of other people who are operating or who are aspiring to do something as well, or to live in their purpose, it starts to stir up that thing inside of you. That's why I said it's important, you know, to be in other groups. Like, this is great, and I would just love more interaction from you guys. it's so helpful, and it keeps you inspired. And I had a conversation with someone the other day, and she was saying herself she need to become more motivated, like self-motivated is her battle. But she may become motivated one day, and then maybe a few days after that feeling leaves. And my answer to her too was, you need to be in some groups with some other women, because this happens to be a woman, some other women who are doing that. This is why support groups are so helpful, because when you feel discouraged and you feel like, I don't even know if I'm going to be able to achieve, or I'm going to finish through, I'm going to make it through the process, constantly conversing with them, participating in activities, it helps you stay accountable, and it helps you stay inspired and motivated. And I told her, I said, how you think I stay motivated? I moved to a whole new place where I don't really have any of my peers, my friends here that I had when I was in New York. But because I am a social being, I know it helps me. I reach out if I have to use social media. That's what I use. And I've connected with a lot of women just on social media alone, where I actually gone to conferences and met them in person. Or we chat on the phone, or we DM each other. We collaborate. I've did summits and they became part of it, you know, and then they're planning things and want me to be part of what they're doing. And so I'm like, wow, it has opened up another platform. And I even have gotten speaking engagements. Come on, somebody, because I've allowed myself to open up and connect. Well, I was already kind of open up in a sense where I love to connect anyway. That's how I thrive, and I understand. If I didn't have that, I probably too would be more mopey and, you know, because I'm not, I don't have anybody else to help stimulate things and help my mind to, stimulate my mind as well, you know, because that's what happens in relationships. If you're in the right relationship, and I'm not talking about intimate, I'm talking about with friends, with colleagues, with your networking groups, whatever kind of, you know, group or association you're part of or affiliation, there's something that bounces back and forth off of one another. And it helps to keep you rejuvenated, and it helps you even stay creative. And that's how I'm able to stay creative, because I can be a part of something, or I can be a part of a group, a mastermind or something, and listening to the other people or hearing or seeing what they're right, because we are, you know, being interactive, it helps me. I did start the flow, you know, or reminds me of something, and I'm like, I get excited all over again. This is how I stay motivated. So I'm telling you, these are some things you could do to stay motivated. So let's go over the assessment that I sent out. The first question was, what do you want to make sure you are getting from the coaching relationship? Because this is really like a coaching group, you know, the whole Purpose, Passion, Finder workshop. And later on, this would also be for those who I'm getting ready to launch. For those of you who have seen this before, I launched my new transformation workshop. That one is, that's really like a course in itself, because that's going to deal with the mindset, and it's a lot of things in that. But these are questions that they're going to answer as well and ask themselves. But because that's another group coaching program. That's what I was getting at as well. So think of other people that are in this with you, in this process with you, and we have expectations. Just like when we go see a doctor, you expect your doctor to be sensitive to your needs, your issues, your pain points. And even a doctor don't have all of the answers, but they can give you some direction, some instruction. They can educate you as well, and they have some solutions, right? And they have some things that can probably help you, because you have doctors that specializes in different areas, you know. So think about that. But you have expectations, just like you would with a coach. And you know, a coach, for those of you who don't know, is different than a therapist. This therapeutic, there's something therapeutic about coaching, because you are addressing needs and it's helping you. There's the accountability piece that also comes along with someone who's giving you counseling, who's counseling you. But the difference is therapy gets deep down into it gets deeper in the emotional healing process, breaking through certain issues and layers of things that underneath that, and it can deal a lot with the trauma. And yes, today we have, and I call myself one too, coaching that is focused on trauma as well, like trauma-focused coaching. But the difference is with coaching, we both offer you strategies. Counseling provides strategies. Coaching provides strategies. But a therapist just gets deeper in that emotional deep stuff, bringing up stuff that can really bring up a lot of feelings and then help you during that process, that whole emotional process. Coaching doesn't stay there. We may help you to discover and uncover what it is that's causing you to feel and think a certain way. We need to know something of your past, some history, but then taking that information, helping you, giving you strategies to learn how to help you kind of deal with that. And part of that, part of the intervention would be to redirect you or to encourage you to see a therapist, a counselor or something, or somebody else to help you in those other areas as well. And this is what I do even in the mental health field. Most of my clients have something called a multidisciplinary team where they're working with a coach. Like I'm the life skills coach, or I'm the parent coach, or I'm the mental health coach. But then they may have a therapist to address a lot of the trauma, because see, they have a focus a lot on that stuff, and then get them to a place of healing and all that kind of stuff. So it's very helpful to have somebody working with you in different areas. If somebody has psychiatric disorder, they may have the psychiatrist, they may have a therapist, and they may have a life coach to deal with daily living skills, things that help them function every day, aside from why they're dealing with all of the other stuff. Learn how to prioritize, learn how to put themselves first. Is that self-care, practice self-care. And even with coaching comes along with strategies for coping strategies and even anger management. I do a lot of anger and emotional wellness and stuff like this. So there is a therapeutic component to it as well, but it's not therapy, but it's therapeutic. So you may be expecting therapeutic in a sense, and it depends on what your goal is. Now, I'm not a business coach per se, so that's not really therapeutic. But the reason why I say some of this could be therapeutic, because it's meeting a need and it's helping you to feel good because you are progressing and you starting to achieve things. You're getting closer to your goal. You got some help. You have some support. That's therapeutic in nature. Feeling good inside about your life and moving forward. So that's what I mean by this therapeutic in that sense. So that's what you really expect from the coaching, from coaching, any kind of coaching you get. I have an example. I want to have someone to whom I am accountable in my commitment to lose weight or to be healthy, to have the right balance of support, understanding, and encouragement combined with pushing and challenging me. That's a good example. So that's what it's about, pushing you, making sure you are, the things that you have maybe spoken about during a coaching session or in this whole process, things you have written down in the workbook. My job is to help you stay accountable. Something like this, coming in and checking on and see where you are in the process. Where are you today compared to when you started, and have you even started yet? And if not, what happened? Because life does happen, things get in the way. And so I'm here to prompt you. I'm here to probe you a little as well, but I'm here to kind of help you if you need some support breaking through some things or learning how to prioritize, because you are a priority. You know, so that's why I ask you, what do you feel like you need in this season in order for you to achieve your goal? And the other clarity question is to help you kind of figure out what your passion and purpose is now. What do you want to do now? Like, what do you see yourself doing right now? Think about that. Is it doing more services? Is it volunteering more? Is it using your creativity? You want to use your hands more. You want to do stuff that makes you feel good inside, or you want to make other people feel good. Ask yourself those type of questions and think about what it is. What is it that I want to do right now? I want to be more available, you know, all of that stuff. The next question is, what area do you need support and accountability in? So I kind of went over that a little bit, except I want you to think about, what area do you need accountability in? Starting, going through the process, finishing. It all depends on where you are. Do you need support in all those areas? I have some examples I was looking at when I talked about, because, you know, even though right now I'm focusing on you guys who's in the Purpose Passion Workshop, you know, I do the relationship and the parenting coaching as well. And that incorporates, you know, healthy communication and behaviors and things like that. So I was looking at when I had examples of relationship and communication. Sometimes you want to improve that. And we need to improve communication always, because we're always communicating all of the time. So that can be an area where you need improvement at. Learning how to express yourself more. Learn how to be more assertive. How to articulate your needs in a relationship or in a working relationship, whatever, coaching process. It helps the other person to understand your needs as well. So if it's hard for you to articulate and I can't understand it, then it's going to leave both of us stuck. So that's an area we could work on. Changing your mindset, right? Maybe your mindset is stuck. Maybe it's stuck on the old way of doing things. Maybe it's stuck on things that you feel like you're lacking in a season, or things that you don't have, and you're stuck on that, and you're not looking at the other little ways that you can still move forward. It may be slower than you want to, but you're still moving forward. Think about, go around and think about, okay, but I can do this in the meantime if I can't do that. I do it all the time. Okay, maybe I gotta leave this here, but I can still work on this piece. So that way you won't stop completely. You're still working towards something and you're writing that down. There should be a section in the workbook where you're writing down all of the small steps, and you're also thinking about what is preventing you from making the next step. Hope that makes some kind of sense. So I see that's kind of something that a lot of people have challenges in too, the mindset. And that's what that transformation workshop is. I can't wait to launch it. I'm completing it now. Dealing with that mindset. If we're stuck in the mind, we won't do anything else. If we're having some conversation in our head that is contrary to the process or the goal, it is negative. It's holding you back. It involves your core beliefs that tend to pop back up, like, you're not gonna be able to do this. I don't think that's for, you know, all of that, though, that's what we call noise, inner noise. A lot of you took communication in college, so you know what I'm talking about. Or even in high school, when you talk about communication 101, you talk about the inner noise that's in your head. And that noise can also be that voice, that core belief that you have. And sometimes we battle with that, and that keeps us stuck. And so we have to work on dismantling that voice and change the language. You always hear me say you got to change your language so you can change that noise in your head, and you'll start to think differently. You have a different mindset and a different perspective and different perception of where you are. So things may be slow, but if you have had a noise in your head that says you're not getting anywhere, so just stop it. You want to change that to, you know what? Things may move a little slow, but I'm still moving forward. And I had a conversation about that today with a client. I said, that is the whole point of changing their perception of where you are. That makes the difference in you moving forward or staying stagnant and stuck. Changing your language and saying, you know what? Oh, and then I also mentioned not to compare yourself with other people are. We all have our own journey. We all got different circumstances in our life. Some of us have family, some of us are single, some of us are married, some of us are not married. And so you have these other people in your life that take up more of your time. Also too, for those of us who are single, and because I just had this conversation with another a woman the other day, I said, one thing I've learned in my own walk is that, I come across a lot of successful women who are doing a lot of things, some on the same level, some are coming up right behind me, and some of them have, of course, surpassed me. You need to be around people who are on different levels. Like they say, if you're the smartest person in the room, something is wrong with that. How can you learn and grow, you know, from somebody else as well? How can you be inspired and motivated if you're always the smartest person in the room, and you get tired of hearing yourself all the time? But my point was, I said, I don't compare myself to maybe some other women that I've met who maybe they have more of the, say, capital, for instance, that they needed to start their business because they had that cushion. You know, for those women who I know who was able to quit their jobs or quit their corporate positions and just go full-time entrepreneur. I said, but I also learned that's great and it's inspiring to me, but I'm not going to worry about what they're doing and where they are, because I also know that some of those women, because some of the ones I'm talking about I married, I also know in their personal lives that because they had a husband who also had was bringing an income, they had that extra cushion that if they was to leave their job today, bills would still get paid. Some of us as single women, I know I'm not the only one, don't always have that luxury until you get to a certain level of income, or you know, multiple streams of income where you're able to do that. You're able to make enough money with your side business or hustle, whatever you want to call it, till you're making either the same that you're making at your current 9-to-5 or contract position, that you can actually leave and put more energy into your business, and then you can grow that exponentially, and you, because you're putting more of your time and money in it. Or you have to just take your time and pace yourself, because you can't do that right now, but you're working towards it. But we don't have the cushion necessarily to do that. They don't have the extra person to lean on, say, babe, I got you. Go and put all your time in that. Some of us got to have the plan. This is the financial planning that prayerfully we're making enough that we can put money to the side for savings, maybe up to that 6 month or a year or more to cover us. So we decide to leave early, whatever our careers or our job or whatever, we know that we're covered for several months ahead, and we know that we're going to go real hard. So by the time that savings is up, you are already good. So there have to be planning for that. That's the whole purpose of goal planning, you know, and what are you working towards? And to remind yourself, like I told a client today, I have to remind you of your goal. You said you wanted to buy this, you wanted to get this, and you need this. So while you're out doing things and you're shopping and you're buying whatever, and you're thinking about a lot of people, that is so awesome. However, don't forget you, don't forget your goal. Because it's going to make you happy, because these things that you say you really want, actually a lot of them you need and you desire, and you know that that will make you happy in life. And so you got to put yourself first as well a lot of times. Okay, number three, I stayed there long, right? What is the pain of not achieving your goal? I think I also have that question in the workbook. What would be the pain of not achieving your goal? Unhappiness, maybe you feel like you're unfulfilled still. You feel like you're stuck, you're not going to be happy, or you're not serving the way you're supposed to serve. Maybe it's a calling that you have on your life, and you feel like if you don't get this, if you don't operate in it and you don't get it out, what is life? And I don't mean that negative sense that you just like, oh, give up. I'm just saying it's like you already know that you're supposed to be doing something else. So of course you feel like, if I don't achieve it, can I live with that? Let that be a catalyst to push you to say, no, I can't. Allow yourself to say, I can't even see myself not doing this. So I got to do it by any means necessary. Everything legally and everything righteous. But you got to do it is what I mean. How will making this change or achieving this goal affect other aspects of my life? Some of you have answered this already in the workbook, some of you haven't, but I also put it in the email. How will this change or achieving this goal affect other aspects of your life? Example, what else might you need to deal with? So we kind of talked about that even in another video that I created. So if there's some other things you need to work on and deal with, so that way you can achieve your goal, work on those things. This change that's coming with your goal, how will it affect your life? Is it going to enhance your quality of life by you achieving this goal? It enhances other areas of your life. You know, think of something that you want to do and how it's going to maybe be better for you, be better for your family. You know what it is. Well, some of you know, some of you still not there yet. You're still trying to figure out. But one thing I wanted to address is someone mentioned about wanting to know what God's call is for them. What's God's gift? So you know who you are. So I'm leaving that anonymous. And you know what? I get this all of the time. So it's so many people that ask this. I've asked the question myself many times. And then he start to reveal and show me. But one of the reasons, I'm going to tell you how that happened. You need, first of all, because if you're a godly person, you're a believer, you're a Christian, whatever, One of the ways to find out what it is that God's gift is in you, what he deposited in you, what he wants you to do, is being in the body of, being part of a body of Christ, being part of a congregation, fellowship, some kind of fellowship with other Christians, other saints, because you will get to see how God used you among your sisters and brethren in Christ. That's how you find out. That's how I found out. I started to see how God was using me. Because when you're talking about gift from God, these are spiritual things. Gifts are spiritual things that God give you. And when you come to God, I'm going to get spiritual for a moment, because you have to go there if we're dealing with the spiritual stuff. The Bible lets us know the Holy Spirit gives gifts to whom he will and pleases. And the Holy Spirit is referred to as he, because it's the Spirit of God. So he is referred to in the scripture as he gives gifts. So the Spirit of God gives gifts to whom he will and to he pleases. He's not a respect of persons, right? So you see that active and activation when you're among the saints, because the gifts are for the edifying of the body. That's the spiritual part. But of course, operating in your gifting from God is a blessing to many people inside and outside the church. Because I'm not talking about necessarily the gifts of the Spirit per se, but I'm saying any gift that God gives you, yes, it's going to affect people in and outside of the church. But if you want to know what your godly gift is, you will see that happen when you're involved in a local body or some kind of meeting together with other believers. This is when your gifts would start to stir up and start to flow. That's how I started recognizing my gift of prophecy, my gift of preaching. It would just happen. And I don't even plan. It's like I would just come in to service per se. This is one thing that's coming back to my mind now. When my pastor at the time recognized a gifting in me, because every time we would have, you know, I grew up more in a Kojic church, right? Church of God in Christ. And so we had testimony service. And so it was a season in my life that just about every time I testified, the testimony was in line with the word for the day. I don't know what the preacher's going to preach about that day, but doing testimony service, I would speak on things and it was exactly tied into whatever the message was going to be for the day. And my pastor said, that is the Spirit of God in you bearing witness to the Spirit in her and what God was doing. And so it confirmed that is that kind of like the word for the day. And it's like, wow. And so that started happening a lot. And I was like, okay. And I recognize it myself even more. And then the prophecy would start to come where I start feeling a word maybe bubble up inside of me, or a revelation. So, you know, that stuff happened because I was around the other saints as well. And that's when God uses us as a body and it starts stirring up the gifts in everybody. And I would get confirmation back, Cheryl, when you said A, B, C, and D, oh my God, this happened to me. Or I had a dream, or they already had the dream, and I would share something with them that I felt God put on my heart, and they would confirm and said, oh my God, I said, you, that ain't me, because I can't do stuff like that. And I realized that was God using me, so I started to see that. So this is one way for sure that you can see God's gifting in you, and you can see your influence with people, your spiritual influence as well with people. I saw the servant in me more in church first, and then I will also see it outside, because there's the natural and it's a spiritual, but there's similar things that you can see in both worlds. I will see how in church that how God would use me to do some kind of way. I was always doing some kind of counseling in some kind of way, some kind of coaching, or became like the go-to person for a lot of answers that people had questions, and they tend to felt like they can come to me, number one, feeling comfortable, number two, in their mind I had some kind of insight. You know, sometimes you don't get it exactly right away when you're new in it, but you realize this is happening a lot, and I realized, yes, there's a certain wisdom that, because God, we all have something. And through life experience, we can share wisdom in certain areas. But I realized spiritually that there was a certain wisdom that God gave me. Because even when I was younger, I would remember older people saying, you know, you had like the old spirit. Like, kind of beyond my years, the way I would think about things. And so now when I'm old and go back, I'm like, whoa, okay, there was something that was there. Now I get it, right? Got it. Now I can see the proof. I can see the evidence of it because of all the different occurrences and encounters that I had. So that's one of the ways to find out what is your spiritual gift, what God have for you, and what God wants you to do out in the world. Because a lot of that stuff, like I said, the natural and spiritual, you'll be doing it out in the world as well. Because that's what I was getting ready to say. Just like I became that counselor type or that preaching type, and that definitely was natural. That just came out. I just couldn't help it. Some of you who know me already know I can go into a preachment in a minute. I don't make myself do it. It just happens. And so even in the natural, I've been that same type of person. No matter what environment I'm in, this seems to be, again, you see me in the workshop, I talk about that theme that follows you. There's that theme again. I become the counselor. I become like, I was speaking to a client not too long ago, and I said, wow, you're like you become a leader in every, it seemed like in all the types of environment that you're in, you become like that leader. You become like the house mother or something like that. And I found that happening to me. So that solidified to me that there's a leader in me. I hope I'm helping somebody, because you keep stepping into this role. And I think I asked a question or said it in the workbook somewhere, finding your shoes. Where are your shoes? What shoes do you wear? And so that was one of the type of shoes I wear. There was a leader in me, and it had to be cultivated. And again, if you're in the right environment, that whatever that is you have inside, that passion, that purpose, it starts to become cultivated and stirred up. And then you hear others, yay-sayers, saying similar stuff, no matter what environment you're in, and you're like, okay, I see something. Something's here. There's a pattern. There's a theme that's happening here. So anyway, I hope that was helpful to you even more. But what I want you to see is the pattern, the theme. I want you to think about what it is you need to do in a season so you can stir up that passion and those gifts and see the influence and what it is you do well, or you know, you feel good about doing it. It makes other people feel good too, right? Like, wow. And what are your yay-sayers saying? You know, we didn't think about the naysayers, because we got some of that going on in our head too, right? That's that noise, that naysayer stuff. But what are the yay-sayers saying about you? What do they feel? I hope you did. If you haven't gotten to that part of the assignment, I can't wait till you get to that part of the assignment, and so you can do it. Because that assignment has you going out on a journey. It's almost like a field trip, okay? And you're going to ask people in different environments, what do they see in you? Do they see a theme? What permeates out of your spirit? You know, how do you make people feel? So that's like an assignment in there. And I want to hear your responses. And if you've done it already, please share it in the comments so I can read it. I want to know what it has done for you and what clarity you got out of that. Because again, that's another indicator of, that you got something in this area. And then of course you want to figure out, what can you do with this strength? What can you do with this passion? Like I said, I'm not just talking about a business. It could be a ministry. Like I said, it can be something you just want to do. It might be you want to be a painter, you know, anything like that. You love to paint. There's a question in the workbook about a secret. What type of maybe gift or talent or skill you have that nobody knows about, too many, or maybe a few people know about, but you don't really share it with the world. And it could be something like you love to paint and you want to start painting more because it can make you feel good. It's therapeutic. It gets your mind off of things. You want to do that more. Your goal can be engaging in more hobbies in your life so you can enhance your quality of life. You're not just working, you're doing things that make you feel good, satisfaction, joy. That could be your purpose, to live a more fulfilled life. You understand? So that's where I'm going with this. So I don't want you to just think, oh, something, some one thing or some business or something I'm supposed to be doing. It's other things that you have inside of you. There's other passions that you want to engage in. I mentioned before, it could be something simple. Like some people are just a part of different type of groups. They go bowling. They're part of a skating they go skating every week with a group of people who like to skate, roller skate. That's fun. That's fun physically, because it's you get exercise, your blood circulation. Oh my God, you're moving those muscles, you're building up strong arms and legs. So you get physical, that makes you feel good. Overall, that decreases stress. Your goal can be, I want to live a stress-free life. I won't say free, I don't want to say 100% free. We have to have a certain level of stress. That's what gets us up and going. But I mean, you're not living a stressed out life. And so we know exercise helps decreases stress levels. And so that could be your goal. More recreation, more leisure activities, more socialization, meeting new friends. That could be the missing piece, you know. You don't have some few friends that you can share your life with and have wonderful conversations and have great company. That could be your goal, to do that. You may have the other things you want and need. You may have that career, that business, that you may be active in ministry or whatever it is you like to do, but you're missing the socialization piece. So I hope that might be something if it is something you need to think about that, and how can you expand that area of your life? Like mine, like I said, be a new place. That started out, maybe social media can open up some new connections. But I want you to get out too. Maybe you need to go to more places. Sometimes you stop yourself because you tell yourself, I don't want to go anywhere by myself. I heard somebody say that not so long ago. It was like, Cheryl, how do you go out and eat by yourself at a restaurant? I'm like, again, let's deal with the perception. I said, you perceive going out to eat as some dang thing you do with it on a date, for dates. I perceive going out to eat is that I'm hungry and I have taste for seafood. I have taste for Italian food, and that's where I'm going to get. Hey, honey, that is what I'm going to get today. So some of you stop yourself from going out to just eat something at a restaurant because you think in your mind that's something you do on a date. Eating out is just eating out. For me, it's like, no, I'm hungry and I want to eat at this restaurant. And see how you can stop yourself in them. That's a mind block. And so you cut yourself off from getting out and doing things and being social, whatever, because you're letting something like that stop you. Like, I'm going to eat at home. I'm not saying, I know sometimes it can get boring eating out alone all the time and you like to have that company, but I'm saying for me, eating is not a date thing. Eating is, my body is hungry. It's a physiological need that I have to put some food in my body so I can have some energy. And so I'm going to go out and have a good time. And I enjoy me. See, this is that self-love thing, but I enjoy my own company. Maybe you need to learn to enjoy your own company more. I love me. I make myself laugh. I can make myself cry. And I'm talking about good cry. I can have my own self rolling on the floor and laughing out loud. Okay? Anyway, I'm done for the night. I hope this was helpful to somebody. I want to know where you are in the Purpose Passion Finder workshop. And I think that's about it. Right? But you people have a good evening. And I'd like to hear from you soon, because I want this group to be more interactive as much as possible. And also is to help you keep you accountable to the process of where you are. Anyway, have a good night, everybody. Bye-bye. And if you watch this, put hashtag replay if you saw it after I went live. Okay, bye-bye.
Don't be that friend. His Garden Naturals.
Nice and smooth, and it's light, right? So it gives a lot of moisture, absolutely. Some nice shine, and it's not heavy. It's not thick.
No, it's not heavy at all.
Oh, wow.
I need this.
This child is not taking my pet. I can't have anything. I can't have nothing. Every time. But keep that, because I have this hand.
Shop by His Garden Naturals. A healthy choice for your hair and body.